national topics of importance to the Jonesboro community. The views expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of KLEK 102.5 FM, the voice of Arkansas Minority Advocacy Council, or our underwriters, donors, or sponsors.
Good afternoon, Jonesboro. My name is Amanda Donovan. I'm your host today for our show, Our Thoughts on the Matter. Right now, I'm having some technical difficulty with our Facebook. I'm sorry, I'll be up momentarily. Today, we're discussing the Stand Your Ground Law. I'm sorry, I'm kind of nervous, having technical difficulties. But anyways, hopefully today you can join our conversation. Today we have Representative Brant Smith, Ms. Emma Agnew, Ms. Jolene, and Ms. Q on our panel today. Hopefully we can discuss what's going on and what to expect, know what the law supports and what it don't, and maybe we can all learn a little bit. And whether you're for or against it, we are here to be neutral, and what you say and do is your opinion and not the opinion of our radio station. Miss Emma, if you don't mind, tell our radio listeners a little bit more about yourself, what you do. And
my name is Emma Agnew. My name is Emma Agnew. I am the current president of the NAACP. I retired from the city of Jonesboro last year, where I worked in community and economic development. I am still involved in the community, and I own a travel agency.
That's neat.
Let's go somewhere.
Matter of fact, Miss Emma is actually helping with the radio station. It's Cozumel, Mexico, wasn't it?
Right. We're planning a fundraising cruise September the 5th out of New Orleans to Cozumel, Mexico. You can still go. Just contact me or someone here at the station for details. Thanks.
All right. Representative Brant, go ahead
and
tell Jonesboro a little bit about yourself.
All right, well, I'm Brant Smith, the state legislator for District 58, and I'm now serving my third term in the legislature, and not only serving District 58, but in the House on the leadership team as the House Majority Whip. And it's a privilege to be here with you today.
All right, Q, we all know Q. She's on our show, Community Conversation. I'm so glad that she's able to be a part of our panel today. And she's just working on the live stream. And luckily, I just got it up and running. It should be posted to our website. If not, somebody let me know. And Brant, what inspired y'all to come up with legislation on the Stand Your Ground Law?
Well, that bill actually belongs to Representative Pilkington, and so that bill was due to run last week in the House Judiciary, but because of some things that he's doing to it, he pulled it back, gonna make some edits or amendments to it, and then bring it back. It should show up in House Judiciary this week.
All right.
Oh, my privilege. I am all about that.
And has there been any kind of backlash people are saying for this bill?
Well,
or have
Amanda,
disagreements
right
on?
Now, because it's not been amended and put back before the committee, I'm getting emails from across the state. I don't try to go out of my way to disregard emails or text messages from other districts, but I'm paying more close attention to what comes out of District 58.
Right.
And since it's not my bill,
right,
I'm not receiving near the concern that maybe Representative Pilkington is.
So. Right. Tommy Baker just came in with us, and there's a few minutes of Laganzi Kale. He's right here.
Sorry, guys.
It's all right. Go ahead and tell Jonesboro, Tommy, a little bit about yourself.
Excuse me. Good morning, Jonesboro. This is Tommy Baker, a former city council candidate for alderman, Ward 6, position 1. I've been in Jonesboro for 10 years. Wonderful family, one wife.
Thank goodness for that, right?
And three beautiful children. And I'm currently a nursing home administrator at Harris Healthcare. Harris Healthcare in Osceola, Arkansas.
Yes, go ahead, Ms. Jolene.
Yes, my name's Jolene Mullett. I am a graduate of Arkansas State University. It's been a while ago, 2004. I am a teacher. I teach at Blytheville High School, 9th and 10th graders. Yeah, I enjoy my job. I have two children. My husband works at Textbook Brokers. He keeps everybody in their Red Wolves gear. And my daughter is a senior at JHS, and I'm proud of her, and I'm getting a little sad. So.
Yeah, boy, that day came too quick, didn't it?
Yes, it did. It really did.
Well, basically, the bill is just an, actually, I look at it as an addition to what's already in place. Arkansas has a pretty strong self-defense law as it is, but under this bill, as it is written now, and we do understand there are some amendments being made to it, is that you are allowed to use deadly force when you don't have to. So you don't have to retreat, you don't have to walk away if that's a possibility, but you can just, as it says, stand your ground and use whatever force you deem necessary. And of course, the problem that we see with that is that when that happens, generally the only two people are the shooter and the shootee.
Yeah,
you don't want to be the shootee.
No, I don't.
The shootee is dead. So it's basically just what you say. And so that's the problem we have with it, along with the fact that we all know this law disproportionately affects people of color, and more particular black males are affected disproportionately by this law.
So correct.
That's, you know, just a general overview and, you know, why we are against it. And we are thankful that Mr. Smith is here today so we can ask him personally, him and his colleagues, to please vote no on this bill, because we see it as an opportunity, and almost all research shows that justifiable homicides go up in a state when they have stand your ground laws, and they go up where whites have killed blacks, not where blacks have killed whites. So we just see it as a very dangerous law. I'm sure Mr. Pilkington was well intended when he brought it up, but it's a very dangerous bill. So we're asking that the representatives think about everyone in the state and vote no against this bill.
Well, and I have not spoken at great length with Representative Pilkington, but I'm looking at the bill right now, and basically, when you, if your listeners will pull up that bill, It is House Bill 1059, and you can find that at the ArcLeg website by putting in the sponsor's name. If you look at the underlined language in his bill, mm-hmm. I think it's important to note that a person who uses or threatens to use physical force in accordance with this section does not have a duty to retreat before using or threatening to use physical force. And that doesn't mean that there's always going to be someone that is threatened carrying a weapon that will pull the trigger, but sometimes just alerting, say, a thief, you know, an intruder, I'm armed and you need to turn around and leave right now. I think that may alleviate some of the concern, but when the attacker doesn't want to retreat and you are there, maybe in a public place, in the privacy of your own home, and you mentioned we do have good laws in place for those intrusions maybe into our homes, but a lot of times these victims, they have no recourse, and if they're carrying a concealed weapon or an open unconcealed weapon, it may in some cases dissuade or persuade the person from actually committing a crime. And so, like I said, I haven't talked with Representative Pilkington other than he's gonna make some amendments, and I don't know what that means. Sometimes a bill goes back to the Bureau of Legislative Research and it's completely amended to where it doesn't really reflect the original intent of the author. So I think we're gonna have to wait and see what comes out of BLR. But that bill will more than likely come to the House Judiciary this week.
Honestly, I mean, we'll seem to be endangered species, but just honestly, just from reading this, you know, even in school, they teach you, you know, to read the beginning and the end of anything,
right.
And you know, the gut of it, you know, that's you know, the detail, but the beginning and the end tells the most. But I'm just looking at it where it says a person is justified in using physical force upon another person to defend himself or herself or a third person. From what the person reasonably believe, that's my question is, how do we define reasonable? Mm-hmm. You know, everybody's reason is different. So I think before this bill passed, those that term reasonable means has to be fine tuned. How do we define that reasonable? Trayvon Martin, situation. He was trying to get out of the situation versus somebody approaching him. That's kind of what I'm looking at. So if my kids or myself or my wife were walking on the other side of the street and someone just approaches me and you know, think that I'm a facetious person just because they may have encountered me last week or something like that, they can reasonably say, hey, this guy is threatening me. You know, I'm just thinking about this thing. You know, let's look at the historics of it all. You know, you just can't say, you just can't look at a person and say, hey man, he's a threat. You know, just because he has on a trench coat.
But
you know,
you have to prove intent.
But how do you prove that?
Yeah, the other person.
Yeah, that's the difficulty right there.
That's the difficulty. I understand what you're saying,
right.
But that also goes to somebody who legitimately needs it. As a self-defense.
Well, I'm not a carrier. I used to carry a long time ago in a former life, but now I don't anymore because I had a whole mind change, my psychological self and all. and we can talk about that later. But I don't carry, so I stick to the status: live by the gun, die by the gun, or live by the sword, die by the sword. You know, some people, when you live that life, usually that should be your demise. But in this case, it's not. You know, it may not be. You know, so I have a great concern with it. You know, being that I'm not a carrier.
Yeah, I don't carry either.
I wish we had a law enforcement personnel here to answer this question, but what could be the backlash also for criminals to try to use that law to their advantage? There was a story here in Craig County. The gentleman, while he was engaged in criminal activity, was being robbed, and he took it upon himself to go after the people and shoot at them. Mm-hmm. I don't know the results of that investigation. However, in a case of that man, in a case like that, okay, then what is it?
That, you know, there's got to be a better example out there that we could use. You know, I mean, what do you say in front of the judge? Well, I was committing a crime, but then they were going to rob me, so I chased them down. I think there's got to be a better example. But I will tell you all from a personal experience, my wife and I were raising our three grandchildren, and she had been raising them. I was deployed to Iraq at the time, but she got custody of the grandkids because our kids, their parents, had serious drug-related problems and some issues, and thankfully they're through that as a result of John 3:16 and 3:17 now. So we're on the other side of that. But during that period of time, we had a member of the Sovereign Citizens Group here in Arkansas, which they're a hateful and a despicable group that... They're haters of everybody, regardless of race. They may hate the African American more than they do the white guy. Right. But, you know, we were threatened that they were going to show up at our home. They were going to murder my wife, my daughter, me, and take the kids away from us. And so at that time, I had a concealed carry permit when I got home. You know, all this was surfacing, and I just came to the conclusion, I will defend my grandchildren and my wife and my daughter if necessary. Mm-hmm. But I did speak with the mayor of our city, Jonesboro. I spoke with Chief Elliott and our prosecutor, Scott Ellington, and explained everything to them. And I just said, if they come to my home, you know, mm-hmm, I'm going to have to defend my home and my family. But there was also that threat that maybe while we were out in community that somebody would approach us and try to take those kids too. Mm-hmm. And so, there are some potential negatives with this, depending on, you know, I'm not a race baiter either, you know, mm-hmm, but there may be some instances where if this bill becomes law, that people of color might feel a little bit more targeted.
Uncomfortable.
A lot. But, you know, it's not just one race against another. Mm-hmm. There are some angry, hateful people out there that want to do us harm. And a lot of it's drug related.
I agree. So, I mean, I have been a victim. Well,
so there are positives too.
Yes.
But we've got to... I'm interested in what Representative Pilkington is doing to the bill.
Right. And from what I understand, it was he's doing a revise for more clarification into certain details in which the Judiciary Committee suggested, this week.
I think he's adjusting the retreat part.
Okay.
The way he's changing the... was changing the bill, said you didn't have to retreat. And mm-hmm, I think the State Sheriff's Association had an issue with that, that if you're able to retreat, mm-hmm, then you need to retreat.
Right.
But so I think he's trying to revise that to make it a little more palatable.
That's how the process works, as you know.
Yeah. And, I was reading... a quote by actress Anne Hathaway last night, and it made me think, that's right. But basically what she's saying is, Black folk fear for their lives every day, especially black men. You know, we've all heard of driving while black, walking while black.
Mm-hmm. That's not like something you can take off.
While black.
You know.
Of course, when something like this comes up, you know, it brings the question why folk are so afraid of black men. Black men have traditionally been the ones that have always not been given the benefit of the doubt, who have been mistreated. And I'm not a race baiter either, but we have to face it. Race is going to play
you have to deal with
Miss Emma, I'm sorry, I'm about to have to cut you off, but we're about to go to break here.
You're listening to our thoughts on the panel.
Y'all have a good 10-15 minute break, and we'll get back right to you.
That's a long break.
I like.
Hi, this is Angie with your KLEK Learn Spanish Minute. So now we are doing greetings. I know that we have covered a lot of greetings, but let's cover some more. Muy bien. Very good.
Muy bien.
Gracias. Thanks.
Gracias.
Por supuesto. Of course.
Por supuesto.
Estupendo. Great.
Estupendo.
Por favor. Please.
Por favor.
Hasta luego. See you later.
Hasta luego.
¿Cómo estás? How are you?
¿Cómo estás?
Bien. Fine.
Bien.
Más o menos. So-so.
Más o menos.
Mucho gusto. Nice to meet you.
Mucho gusto.
Great. Perfecto. I'm Angie, and that was your Learn Spanish Minute on KLEK 102.5 FM.
Calling all women and minority business owners as well as the general public. KLEK 102.5 FM presents the 2019 Women and Minority Business Showcase, Saturday, February 16th from noon until 6 at Centennial Hall in the Arkansas State University Student Union. Live broadcast on KLEK and on Facebook, this is your opportunity to show what your business, church, or organization has to offer to the unique, diverse audience of KLEK listeners, supporters, and the Jonesboro community as a whole, or to just check out all the vendors in attendance. Vendor registration is $25, $50 if you sell items on site, and you can register at klekfm.org, but you must register by February 4th. Free admission to attend. The KLEK Women and Minority Business Showcase is sponsored by the Arkansas State University Office of Diversity and Community Engagement, Full Sun Gifts, and Bancorp South. This event is a KLEK fundraiser.
Meineke of Jonesboro is now Starks Auto Service, a full-service auto repair and vehicle maintenance center offering engine and transmission repair, brake service, tires, oil changes, and more performed by ASE certified mechanics. Starks Auto Service, 2813 South Caraway Road in Jonesboro, 870-204-7112. Starks Auto Service, Jonesboro.com.
And now back to our thoughts on the matter on KLEK 102.5 FM.
Thank you all for joining us back after our break. We are now everything straight. The Facebook going good. It's heated up. I would like to do a shout out to Mark Pillow and Shaquetta Cunningham and David Carnes and Allie J. I love you. And let's see here. We've got some Facebook comments. I told everybody, thank you for watching. Mark said, I didn't carry for years. Then I had a heart attack. Understood. And he also said, sovereign citizens are real. Yes, we know they're real. We've seen, you can look it up on YouTube. And it's been all over the news. Shaquetta Cunningham joined the conversation. And she said, not a mite, unfortunately. And she also said, glad to hear these conversations is happening. Thank you, Shaquetta. This is what this program is about, for everybody to be able to have a platform they can speak on and in a level playing field. So that's what one of the reasons why I love this show is we can bring some topics to the table. Let's see here. Mark says, if anything, this law ought to support a minority's unquestioned right to defend themselves. And then Shaquetta was joking about my 15-minute comment, which we all know that was
too.
A joke. And Quabella said, not quite so long, Chiquetta. And then I told everybody 29 seconds, and everybody said, great. Amanda Faye says, good morning. Oh, oops, she meant afternoon, I mean. That's all right, I understand. I still screw that up from time to time. But we were discussing the stand your law ground and things that would like to be seen changed and the rewrites, the reason why they're being rewritten. And my question is it a good thing or is it a bad thing? That's my thing, my question. I believe in our Second Amendment right. I don't hide that. The concealed to carry, you know, if you want to have a concealed to carry license, get it. If you want to openly support, like I do, the constitutional carry. But here's the thing, a gun you have to be responsible for. To me, I think it's a person problem, the heart problem, the understanding problem. We don't need to jump to the first thing is to pull a gun and shoot somebody. Even if it is an out danger, you're going to get shot. Trust me, I have been there, and you can go to the courthouse and look it up. But we still need to have that right. That is a God-given right to, you know, for those who are born here. My family has fought and died for, but this is my opinion. But we also need to make sure that there isn't victims of these laws that, and like it, unessential murders, you know what I'm saying, when that person could flee instead of turning and shooting somebody. Now, that could go on all sides of the fence, you know, but I stand by our protection for our Second Amendment rights. And I myself is a survivor of gun violence on many occasions, but we need to really pay attention on how we write our laws and figure out what is acceptable and what's not. But that's just my opinion. What's y'all's?
It seems to me that the laws right now seem to be strong enough. But like Miss Emma said, right? Because didn't we just, and maybe if I'm getting details wrong, but not too long ago, wasn't there that robbery out past Brooklyn at the vape shop where the guy came in, he felt threatened and he shot him dead. And like, there's no case going afterward. They're cleared of everything. Seems pretty strong to me.
But he was an armed robber who went into that man's store.
That's true. Okay.
Now me as a landlord, I have to take money. I have over, I believe it's 10 units that you, I believe, don't quote me on that because I have way more, but anyways, we take money, even though there isn't cash money sitting out everywhere because we don't keep anything over $100 because of what we have to live through as a landlord. You know, people think we have all kinds of money in the house, and my great-grandmother and my grandmother were the only ones living there. And we've actually had people try to break in on us trying to steal my grandmother's money. Now, she's been able to, yes, pull it, but no, didn't shoot nobody because she talked them out of leaving. Sort of kind of like Jan Morgan went through, what, was it last weekend or this past weekend, this past week, where her and her daughter was there at the gun range, and a gentleman come up and wasn't leaving and was threatening to rob her. And now she didn't shoot him, but she pulled it and said, hey, I'm not, you know, I'm giving you a warning. Get out or get shot.
But let me just say this. I want to clear this up. This law is not about you being inside your home and someone coming in and endangering you. There is a law on the book that protects that self-defense.
Yes,
that's obvious.
This is for out in public.
To my home, I'm gonna take I don't carry, but I'm gonna take the first thing I can find and go upside your head to protect my house and my
iron skillet
and my family.
Hey, my neighbor can contest about me and my iron skillet.
I don't want y'all to be confused by people, you know, by this conversation leading to, you know, what happened while I was in my home.
Right.
There are laws on the book that already protect that.
Right. This is for out in public.
Talking about something happening outside the home where you have an opportunity to walk away or back away, and you're not guessing. You know, Tommy was concerned about reasonable. I'm concerned about imminent. Who decides what's imminent?
Right.
How do you know what someone is thinking? So basically what this says, I can shoot you because I think you're gonna cross the street and harm me. And I can get away with it because you're not gonna be around to see. I was just crossing the street because I was going to buy a pack of cigarettes.
That's it.
So I don't want this to be confused with you being able to defend your family, your home, your property.
Mm-hmm.
There are laws on the book that that already covers that. And I'm not against carrying a gun.
Right.
You know, if people want to carry a gun, that's up to you. But as Amanda said, you have to be responsible.
I agree with that.
And now, Mark Pillow has posed a question, and it is a good question. And I do kind of like this idea. No, not because I love you, Mark, but it is really a good idea.
She loves you.
What does the panel think of a sunset clause or a 2-year review requirement? So what he's talking about is if this act or bill comes forward, we give it 2 years.
Like a probationary period.
Probationary period where we come back and evaluate. I know, Jolene, you were wanting to state something, and I'm sorry.
Well, Moore had a question. Are we saying, and I'm sorry, I did read this. I am an English teacher, but legalese kind of makes me a little confused sometimes. But
the wording.
My question is, are we saying it's okay to shoot a totally unarmed person? Like, this person doesn't have a gun or a weapon, and they're not.
If you say, I thought that's pretty he had reasonably. A gun, yes.
That's pretty scary
to
me.
I thought he had a gun. Okay. I thought he had a knife.
Or he could have just been some big buff guy.
Yeah, I thought he was going to strangle your muscles me. Okay. You know, so it's saying that's okay.
Okay. Hmm.
There's another question. Yes. Let's see here. We've got a couple of comments and questions on our Facebook live feed. Laws are instituted in a social context as well. The country is not in a place to be socially responsible to have a more extensive use of guns in this country. Pandering to fear is driving certain platforms, and it is extremely dangerous for many communities. And Mark Pillow said, it is easier to talk someone into leaving when looking over a barrel of a Dillinger. And Stan Morris said, there is a grand jury hearing on the robbery at Emerald's Triangle. FYI, it wasn't just cut and drop for several reasons. One of the biggest issues was it's clearly in self-defense, I was told. The grand jury returned a decision not to pursue charges, but the prosecutor did convene them. Trayvon Martin didn't have a gun, but Stand Your Ground allowed him to be killed without charges.
Mm. Yes, and that's what we're talking about in Arkansas. That was in Florida.
Yeah, I remember that.
Let me kind of weigh in here, if you don't mind.
Go ahead, please, Representative Brent.
And you know, I'm a private citizen as well as a state legislator, but I don't carry my Glock every day. Some days I do, and most of the time I don't. But if I'm in a public place and I happen to have it on me, and I'm there in a place where I can carry, you know, there are some restrictions on where we can and cannot carry. But if I'm in a public place and I see a robbery taking place, even if it's armed robbery, and the money is just being handed over and the guy is gonna head for the door.
Mm-hmm.
I'm probably not going to pull my weapon and make a mess out of it. Yeah.
Right.
But if I notice, if I'm down the aisle and I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, you know, he not only is threatening, but now he's actually shot someone.
Mm-hmm.
Then that's when I'm going to draw my weapon and I'm going to protect not only myself, but the others in that convenience store. So I'm going to be more slow to react. I'd rather be prepared. Mm-hmm. But I don't think this bill, the intent of Representative Pilkington, is to give people a free pass to just go out hunting down people. And so as it now stands, I will be voting in favor of it. But I'm looking forward to seeing what amendments he's put on this thing.
Right.
I think that's important too.
Well, let me say, I don't think anybody in here believes that there will be a preponderance of people going out hunting down people.
Yeah, I don't either.
I don't believe that. Mm-hmm. But what I do believe is that black men are feared and make folk feel threatened more often than not. They can be very harmless, like Tommy. He's a reasonable size young black man. bald head. You know, somebody
got me.
Yeah. So people, just his appearance for some reason, which I will never understand, threatens people. And so under this law, they are able to say, I felt threatened. I shot him because I felt threatened. He's got a wife and kids at home. You know, he's an upstanding mm-hmm. citizen, but just looking at him, you felt threatened. And so chances are you get away with it. So we're not saying we think people are just gonna go out hunting down mm-hmm. black men or
well,
whoever.
We hope that doesn't happen.
Well, right. I don't think that's gonna happen. That's not the point. The issue is, I think what's gonna happen is in all the other states that have passed the law, research shows that shooting of black men have gone up in every state that has passed Stand Your Ground law. You can Google it, look it up right now. It shows that it has gone up in every state.
And let me just add a point right quick. I wasn't intending to actually jump in on this, but I was listening in the office and I wanted to bring this up. By the way, this is Laganza Kale, KLK General Manager. These thoughts are my own. I want to speak to the fear of a black man. Being a black man myself, even though most people would probably find me unassuming, but you kind of just grow up as a black man having fear that people are fearful of you. Like when I'm out and about town, like if I am around certain people, I find myself trying to go the extra mile to disarm people. I'll give you an example. One time I was in the office and there was an elderly Caucasian lady in the office with me, and my instinct just kicked in to be extra friendly to her, to make the first move, say, ma'am, how you doing? I'm smiling at her, I'm watching my hands, because, you know, deep down inside as a black man, we're thinking that this person probably thinks that I'm a thug or I'm mm-hmm. harmful, I'm this big, mean person. So I'm conditioned, and it's sad that it's like this, that I feel like I have to disarm you. I have to show, no, I'm not a menace, I'm not a threat to you. Mm-hmm. And so that's, you know, that's how I go about living my life. So I just want to jump in and offer that perspective right quick.
Thank you, Kanzi.
Thank you. That's a good point. Yeah, as I said, you know, like Anne Hathaway was saying, black people feel threatened every day of their life. You know, my thing, most folks...
I need to go read that article with Anne Hathaway.
It wasn't an article, it was just a quote.
Oh, okay.
But for, I think most black folk and those listening can weigh in. Even driving down the street when a police car gets behind you and turn their blue lights on, your heart starts to race.
Well,
you know, oh my God.
Miss Emma,
God.
I can understand how you feel, because that's the way I feel every time I'm getting pulled over.
No, you don't feel like I feel.
Lord.
Amanda, you do not feel like I feel. Don't even claim that when I get pulled over by a police officer.
I do.
No, you don't. You don't know how I feel. How can you say that?
Well, I know I start having a heart palpitations. I'm concerned about what I did wrong.
You're not concerned about getting shot.
Maybe.
No, don't tell me that.
Honey, I had a soldier and also a Craighead County used to be deputy sheriff put a gun in my face. Yes, I am scared.
Let me jump in. The greater fear came when the media started to push the what's that Francisco guy up north. That was a few years ago. He got shot in his car. He had a concealed weapon, and he said, I have my gun, and so on and so forth. He got shot in his vehicle. The Louisiana incident, various incidents where a black man got killed. Carrying their gun, and the cops feel threatened. I don't know the full story, you know, as to what happened. I'm from Osceola, Arkansas. Mississippi County has a high crime rate. In fact, Jonesboro is infiltrated by Mississippi Countyans as to why the crime rate has went up.
Right.
And you still feel that sense of fear of being judged or mistaken, you know, even being from that city. And then you come to Jonesboro. Now, back in the day, it was all whites, you know, it really was. And I came over for band camp, but I didn't feel that fear when I was in band camp, because I was in an isolated area. Mm-hmm. I didn't think about that till I became an adult. And I started to see the media and started to have various conversations, and my mind has opened up more. So I'm trying to see it from all sides here, you know. But I don't want this to turn into a black, white, race matter. We're talking about stand your ground, you know, gun laws. Not like Miss Emma was saying, not in your home, but we're talking about in the streets. And I'm talking about reasonable. I'm talking about this wording. I mean, even the English teacher read this document and it said it's confusing.
Right, and it has it is 2/4 on the Judiciary Committee in order to get rewritten where it's more understandable.
But who is the advocate for us to actually help the verbiage?
Well, I think we have to take that amongst ourselves. And while I got the microphone, I turned down 4 just a little bit. 4 is a little hot.
It's hot because it's tension.
That means it's broadcast.
It's too loud. It's too loud.
I wasn't gonna come back to the table, but I just could not.
He's bad.
Sit still, Amanda. With all respect to you, Mrs. Agnew is right on that one. Look at that picture on the wall. I want everybody look at that woman on the wall. My mother, Lovette McHale. Everybody knows that this station was named after her. When I was a teenager, before, you know, you were seeing black men being killed by police at an alarming rate, I remember getting the talk. You know, most people get the birds and the bees talks. When you grew up as a black young man in a black household, you get another kind of talk.
Yeah.
And the talk is, you ever get stopped by police, don't try nothing funny. Mm-hmm. Say yes sir,
right,
no
right.
sir. You
do what's right.
That is the same conversation. I'm sorry.
This is my general manager hat on now.
I know, I understand.
But seriously, I had that talk. She was like, you know, don't let them win it because you might lose your life. I mean, that can apply to anyone, but it goes doubly so for African Americans. Like, if you just look at the news reports today, you see several incidents where police have encountered white suspects who have done things that should have automatically granted them getting killed. Like, you know, when I went to the Citizens Police Academy, you know, they taught us that if you make a threatening move towards an officer, that justifies deadly force. And there have been incidents where white people have encountered cops that pulled guns on them, waved guns in their faces, and were still taken in alive.
Yeah.
We, as black people, don't have that privilege. I mean, even if it's suspected, they're going to think something and we're going to get killed. I mean, and that's just one of the things that you're just not going to understand. Mm-hmm. It's just the same as me. I'll never know what it's like to be pregnant because I'm not a woman.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right.
You know,
right.
It's one of those things that no matter how you explain. And again, I'm not saying this to put anybody down. I'm just here to.
I think you've got to have a kidney stone to even get close to that.
Like I told Amanda, no,
I've heard.
Because I haven't had a kidney stone.
We hope you don't.
All right, we won't have time to read these Facebook comments. We'll catch them on the other side of the break.
All right. After our break, we'll discuss our Facebook comments. Thank you, Adrian, for tuning in. And Shaquetta, thank you for all your comments. And Stan Morris, you as well. We'll get back to this right after our break.
No, I'm good.
You're listening to our thoughts on the matter on KLEK 102.5 FM. We'll be right back.
Pressure is yet another good reason for kids to get off the couch, pull away from the video games, TV, and computer monitors, and get some exercise. Teenage boys in particular are showing increased incidences of heightened systolic blood pressure, the larger of the two numbers that comprise a blood pressure reading. The reasons could be hormonal, with the onset of puberty playing a role, but a sedentary lifestyle and lack of exercise increase the chances of having higher systolic blood pressure. For unknown reasons, this is true more for boys than girls. Men are usually more prone to hypertension, chronically elevated blood pressure that can lead to heart disease. The fact that this trend begins in childhood is startling. Boys need exercise. I'm Alexis Comer for Black Health Now. Black Health Now.
Black Health Now is made possible by the Jonesboro Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, a nonprofit organization focused on joy in our sisterhood, power in our voice, and service in our hearts. www.jonesboroalumnidst.org.
Black Health Now is brought to you by the Guide Right Jonesboro Kappa League, a nonprofit organization that guides young men to a life of achievement. Kappa League Jonesboro on Facebook, Jonesboro_Kappa League on Instagram, and JonesboroKappaLeague@gmail.com.
Experience the joy with Bishop Adrian R. Rogers, pastor of Fullness of Joy Church, 2120 Thorn Street, Jonesboro, Arkansas, 72401. Wednesday night, Word and Worship, 7 p.m. Prayer Thursday night at 7 p.m. Sunday School, 9:30 a.m. Sunday Morning Worship, 11 o'clock a.m. And our Sunday Night Live Service at 7 p.m.
And now back to our thoughts on the matter on KLEK 102.5 FM.
Thank you all for tuning in. We are our thoughts on the matter on KLEK 102.5 FM. This segment is a little bit shorter than most. We have 8 minutes left, and so, Gansy Kale's going to read off some of our comments.
I'm going to go ahead and get into our Facebook comments. Shanquetta Cunningham says, good intentions often lead to wrong results. Stan Moore says, great perspective. Stan says, Amanda is different. Shanquetta says, no ma'am. Mark Pillow says, I'm out. Shanquetta says, nervousness and fear of life is two different things. Shanquetta then says, Philando Castile. Teresa Jones says, any person that looks at stand your ground. Shanquetta says, Sandra Bland. Amanda replying to Shanquetta, big difference. Jay Nindo Vincent, hopefully I pronounced that correct. I don't agree with this law. We have too much killing now. This just allows people to kill on at any whim. I'm a gun owner, but a responsible gun owner. How about we make gun owners more responsible? Leave a gun unsecured in your vehicle or home, and if it's stolen, it's a crime. Stan says, as a white male, I've never had that experience or conversation, and even if I had, I wouldn't know what it's like to be feared for skin tone when I'm a harmless, innocent man. I'm going to just expound on that, kind of what I said earlier. Like, here in Jonesboro, I still get a little nervous when the officer's behind the van. Not as much because, I mean, I am known in this community. Everybody knows the KLEK van. Everybody knows the relationship I have with Chief Elliott. But if I step outside of Jonesboro where nobody knows me, that fear is at 100%. Adrian Everett says, hey everyone. Teresa Jones says, the conversation for a white child and a black child are different. Black children have to be the bigger person and de-escalate a situation that the officers escalate. That kind of goes back to my earlier comment for when I encounter people, how I find myself being extra friendly as opposed to my normal introverted self. Stan says, this is great. Keep it going, Leganzi. Please keep it at the table. Teresa says, I've literally had a Coldwater Mississippi State Trooper pull me over for passing a lady texting and driving. Teresa says, the officer pulled a gun in the middle of winter while my newborn was in the car. My newborn's crying was the only reason he put his gun back in the holster. Stan says, for replying to Teresa, I'm so sorry. Teresa says, stand your ground were the first words he used with me. And Amanda replied to Adrian, hey. So you kind of get a feel in the comments from the different perspectives that goes with it. And I think when it comes to discussing this law, I think context plays a big part of it, especially in the framework of your life experiences. Whereas people on one side are going to feel one way because of their life experiences, where people on the other side are going to feel the other way, life experiences. I think the thing that you have to remember and keep in mind, I don't think nobody is saying that you should not defend yourself, but unfortunately some people will take that and use it as an excuse to do something that goes beyond defending yourself and actually becoming an aggressor.
I totally understand that point, but I want to put this out to the panel for our last question. You are standing in a gas station and one person, no matter what color they are, they have a gun, okay? They have came to help you during an armed robbery situation. Would you want that person thrown in jail for saving your life? Now, I understand laws need to be written to protect the other side and everybody in between, but that's my question to the panel.
Well, I'll...
I don't quite understand your question.
Well, I understand, so I'll answer. Okay.
Okay, well, explain it then.
Okay, she's asking if you're in a gas station, that gas station being robbed, someone comes in with a gun and stops it, should that person get in trouble? And my answer would be no, because the person that was robbing obviously had ill intent, had a negative intent. I think, again, the issue is where people are getting killed that did not have a negative intent.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, that person is in the commission of a crime. If I'm not mistaken, that's already on the books. If you walk up someone in the commission of a crime, you have a right to use force to prevent that.
Right. We have one of these convenience stores in Jonesboro that I entered maybe a year or two ago, and they have a sign on their door, and it says, "We respect your right to carry, you know, openly or concealed." If there is a crime being committed in our facility, we just ask that you be accurate. That was really on the door.
All right. We got some more Facebook comments. Shanquetta says, my mention of Sandra Bland, was to add to the severity of getting stopped by police from our reality. Donna Humble says, I believe in the right to protect yourself. However, I feel this law can cause some major problems based off technicalities, personal experience, difference between a manslaughter charge or a murder charge. Don't we already have the right to defend ourselves?
Yes.
Then she says, exactly. Stan said they wouldn't be under current law. Shanquetta says this is immediate danger. And Zach Chang said that question was incredibly poorly phased.
I'm sorry, I'm working on that.
I will say this. The reason why race comes up so much is because there hasn't been active solutions or some form of resolute.
Well, yeah, we haven't confronted the demons of our past.
We must talk about these things. Otherwise, this conversation will continue to pop up. We came here to talk about stand your ground, and race came out. We're talking about it. It's part of it. It's part of it, but the resolve haven't come about race. Because one person will say, well, I don't see color.
That's why we're
afraid. I see color.
That's why we're afraid of it. But
you can't help it.
You can't, yeah. I can't help the fact I was brown. I was born brown.
I can say that every day, all day long. I don't see color.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but actually, that's not true.
Right.
I'm not colorblind.
You're not.
Even if I try to be.
You're not even medically deemed colorblind.
Well, thank you for that right there. Sir. Yeah.
We have... a Facebook comment. Kayleen
Nazim,
I'm sorry if I butchered that. This is the same law that killed Trayvon Martin. I think it was insensitive for white mediator to employ a woman. She knows how a black woman feels when she is pulled over by police. She must remember that white privilege is on her side. Well, for those who do not know, I am not just white. I am Native American. If you do not, you know... We're talking about, how do you know? Yes, that may have been a little bit insensitive. I'm sorry, Miss Emma.
You look white.
Well, I'm sorry, anybody who can look at me. See, that's what I keep talking about.
Right.
We are being judgmental, even though we're not noticing we're being judgmental. Again, I'm
that's
sorry, Miss Emma.
That's
I'm sorry, Miss Emma.
Amanda.
Well, we don't want this to go. We don't want this to go south because we got about.
I want to give this contact information before we leave.
Yes, contact information.
Your representative, you can contact Mr. Smith, and hopefully he will give his contact information before we go off the air. But Aaron Pickleton is the sponsor of this bill. His email is aaron.pilkington@arkansashouse.org. His phone number, 479-308-8384. Call or email Mr. Pilkington. Tell him how you feel about this bill and ask him to vote the way you think he should vote. He's going to vote yes. If you support that, let him know. Hopefully most listeners do not, and that you will tell him no. Be respectful.
Excuse me.
Be familiar with what you're talking about and explain to him why you want him to vote no, because I honestly don't think he has any ill intent. Mm-hmm. So we need to let him know what we are looking at if this bill passes.
All right,
so
we're getting ready to go to our conclusion.
Yes.
Representative Smith, go ahead, give your information, and then I'll close this out.
All right. Again, Brandt, B-R-A-N-D-T, Smith, and my cell number is 870-351-7459. And please text me and or let your message go to the voicemail box, and I'll see your comments there or hear them. My email address is brant.smith@arkansashouse.org.
All right, thank you, Representative Smith. And my final comment is we get ready to get out of here, and this is in response to the situation with Amanda. I mean, one may be mixed, but unfortunately, like Representative Smith says, you know, first thing people see is one way or the other, unless you, you know, have like several more layers of pigmentation. And it's not right that we are judged that way, but unfortunately, you know, first impressions are everything. And unfortunately, we live in a country where first impressions could potentially cost you your life. Panel, good discussion. Appreciate each and every one of you for checking in. Of course, these are the opinions of those of the participants, including myself. It does not necessarily reflect the views of KLK 102.5 FM, the Voice of Arkansas Minority Advocacy Council, or our underwriters, our donors, or our sponsors. But we definitely thank each and every one of you for stopping by the studio today. And definitely thank you for this discussion, because this is only how we heal. You know, Brother Tommy yes. mentioned that we definitely have a lot of wounds that we have to heal. And the only yes. way we're going to heal those wounds is if we talk about things that aren't comfortable, that right. may cause us to get in our feelings. So, but the good thing is we're all adults here, and we can talk, and we can walk out of the studio, and we can shake hands, and we can still can go to the cookout. So thank you guys and gals. Thank you all for everyone who's tuning in. We'll be back next Saturday. My guy BT Groove is up next. This is Our Thoughts on the Matter on KLEK 102.5 FM.
Thank you for listening to Our Thoughts on the Matter on KLEK 102.5 FM. A program offering opinions from all sides of the issues concerning local, state, and national topics of importance to the Jonesboro community. The views expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of KLEK 102.5 FM, the Voice of Arkansas Minority Advocacy Council, or our underwriters, donors, or sponsors.